Hello everyone, today we will start our new unit that is focused on radiation. Until now we have seen all the laws related to thermodynamics and related definitions. We have seen a lot of laws like Maxwell thermodynamic relations. We have seen how to liquefy the gases and we have seen all the related laws. Now this is a slightly different section of thermodynamics that is focused on radiation. So the objective of today's lecture is divided into three key points. One is to understand the radiation and related concepts. Second point is to understand black body radiation and related laws. And finally, we will see to learn about the pressure of radiation if time allows. The outcome after attending this lecture, you will be able to learn about the basic definitions that are related to radiation. Secondly, you will be able to understand about black body, what is black body, and you will see many researchers have proposed their own type of black body. They have prepared different structures of black body. So you will see different black bodies, different structures, and you will understand the related phenomena. The last point of this lecture will be related to different laws that are governing the radiation phenomena. Okay, so to achieve these objectives, these are the content of today's lecture. One is radiation. First, we will understand the radiation, normal radiation. And then we will see what is thermal radiation. Then the next topic will tell us about Purvo's theory of heat exchange. And then we will move to the concept of black body. We will see two different types of black body that were prepared by Perry, and second was prepared was by Beans. The next topic is related to Kirchhoff's law. And finally, if time allows, we will see the derivation of pressure exerted by radiation. Here are the reference books which you can consider for further study or to solve some problems if you want. These are very simply written and easy to understand. Okay, so let us start to understand what is radiation. Actually, in your previous classes, you must have studied about the heat transfers, how the heat transfer occurred. It can occur from one point to another by three different methods. Number one is conduction, second is convection, and third is radiation. In this lecture, we will not focus on conduction and convection. Our focus will be on radiation. The conduction and convection, actually, the conduction and convection requires the presence of any material medium when the heat is transferred from source to receiver. There should be some material medium. But for radiation, it is totally different. Radiation can be occurred, the heat transfer by radiation can be occurred without any material medium between source and receiver. That means it can happen in vacuum condition also. Okay. Now, once we understand the basic property or basic definition of radiation process, we will now understand what is thermal radiation. So, according to Maxwell, he was the first one who actually defined thermal radiation. He said, thermal radiation is defined as the transfer of heat from a hot body to cooler body. Okay, this we have seen already in thermodynamics also. So, in the basic laws of thermodynamics, we have seen that the heat transfer occurred from the higher temperature body to cooler body temperature if there is no external source of energy. Something similar was defined by Maxwell for the thermal radiation. So, the heat transfer occurred from a hot body to cooler body without appreciable heating of intervening medium. There is no heating of the intermediate medium. Okay, this heat or thermal energy is propagated by radiation and it is very similar to energy propagation. So that means we can say that heat or thermal energy is also a type of electromagnetic wave, as we call energy as an electromagnetic wave. So that's why the thermal radiation has several properties which are quite similar to light actually. So the first property is thermal radiation has electromagnetic wave nature, and because of that it travels through empty space and no material medium is necessary, and that traveling is done by the velocity of light. So that is very similar property as that of light. Light is also electromagnetic wave nature and can travel through empty space. There is no material medium is necessary. Okay, second property is it is also again very similar to light. Thermal radiation travels in a straight line. Okay, the third property is thermal radiation obeys the law of inverse square. The last property of, it's not last, but actually this is the key property. The last property says that it exhibits all the laws, rules, phenomena which are valid for light. That means for heat or thermal radiation, reflection, refraction, interference, diffraction, polarization, all the phenomena that occurred for light are valid. It occurred for the thermal radiation also. Okay. Now, if we are saying that thermal radiation can be considered as a electromagnetic wave radiation, right? So if it is electromagnetic wave radiation, then it should have some place on the wavelength spectrum. So if you see on this picture, this is showing the wavelength spectrum. Now on this wavelength spectrum, if you focus, this thermal radiation is showing by the red pink color part, okay, red pink color area. So if you look at this, it covers some part of ultraviolet region up to infrared region completely, and in between there is a visible region also, right? So the wavelength of thermal radiation lies between 4000 to 8000 angstrom almost. Okay, this is the thermal radiation spectrum. Now we will understand, before going to the black body and other laws that are governing black body or the concept of radiation, we need to learn some definitions, because we are going to use several terms which are quite new for our knowledge. So we will learn that definition before going to the detailed studies of radiation laws. So the first term is total energy density. It is represented by U, and the energy density of radiation is defined at any point as a total radiant energy per unit volume. You know, density for anything is represented by per unit volume. So here, since it is total energy density, that means total radiant energy per unit volume around that particular point for all wavelengths taken together. We are not focusing on particular wavelength or a wavelength of range. We are saying that for all the wavelengths taken together, the total radiant energy per unit volume is defined as total energy density. And since it is energy density, it has a unit very similar to energy density, that is joule per meter cube in SI unit, or arc per centimeter cube, that is in CGS system. Okay. Now the second definition is for spectral energy density, that is represented by U lambda. Just now we have learned about total energy density, and there we talked about for all the wavelengths taken together. But now, since it is saying spectral energy density, that means everything is same except the wavelength. It is considered as for the unit range of wavelength. So spectral energy density for a particular wavelength is the energy radiant per unit volume per unit range of wavelength, and denoted by U lambda, right? Now the third definition is related to emissive power of any system, of any body. So the total MSA power, or we can call it MACBT also, it can be represented by capital E and is defined as the radiant energy that is emitted per unit time per unit surface area of that body. For, because this is total MSA power, so this is for all the wavelengths taken together. It is very similar case for all the wavelengths, that is defined for total energy density. So here also, since we are taking total MSA power, that means the radiant energy per unit time per unit surface area of body is defined as total MSA power. Now we will go again to spectral MSA power. This is also the same case as we defined total energy density and spectral energy density. Here total MSA power for all the wavelengths together, but for spectral MSA power, this is at particular wavelength, the radiant energy emitted per unit time per unit surface area, that is defined as spectral MSA power, and the wavelength range should be unit. Within a unit wavelength range, the radiant energy emitted per unit time per unit surface area, it is denoted by a small e lambda. Now if we talk about perfect black body, now perfect black body, e lambda should be maximum, because it absorbs whatever it emit also the same quantity. So that means E lambda should be maximum and can be represented by capital E lambda, that is particularly for black body only, right? Now the next definition is absorptivity. Here we see emissivity. Now this is related to absorption power, right? So that's why we are calling it absorptivity or absorptive power, and it is denoted by a small a lambda. So the definition says the absorptive power of a body at a particular temperature and for a particular wavelength is defined as the ratio of radiant energy absorbed per unit surface area per unit time to the total energy incident on the same area of that body in unit time within a unit wavelength range. This is absorptive power. This is not a total absorptive power. Okay, it is different. So that's why we are saying within a unit wavelength range. Okay, and it is denoted by a small a lambda. Now if we combine this definition and all these four definitions, what we get, we can write that U is equals to within integration limit of 0 to infinite of U lambda d lambda is total energy density. Similarly, total MSA power or emissivity, okay, emissivity, capital E can be written as integration within limits 0 to infinite of E lambda d lambda. This is the definitions and these are the relations between total energy density and spectral energy density. Similarly, total emissivity or total emissive power to spectral emissive power, right? Now the next term we will define as relative emittance. So the ratio of emittance of surface to the emittance of a black body, this is giving a relationship between the emittance of particular body surface to the emittance of black body, is known as relative emittance. Now if we consider that E dash is the emittance of a given surface and E as a emittance of a black body, then the relative emittance of the surface can be written as E equals to capital E dash upon capital E. E is the emittance of black body and this is for our given body. Okay, so this is the relative emittance. Now after learning all these definitions, we will understand the very important theory of heat exchange that was proposed by Prevost. Okay, the idea regarding radiant energy was considered slightly strange, slightly different before 1972, when this theory was proposed. it was considered in earlier time that all the hot bodies radiate hot radiation and the cold bodies radiate or emit the cold radiation. Right. In that time, it was considered that this is the hot body, so it is giving us hot radiation. That is the cold body or something, ice or something, it is giving us cold radiation. But actually, Provost of Geneva, he said this consideration is wrong. Provost said that thermal radiation is actually an exchange process. It is not a one-way process. It should be the exchange process between the two bodies or one body and its surrounding, right? The increase in temperature or decrease in temperature of a body is due to the exchange process bit of radiant energy between these two bodies, right? So if we understand this concept in a statement form, we can write, according to Provost, every body emit radiations continuously to its surroundings at the particular rate, which actually depend only on the nature of its surface and temperature. And at the same time of radiation emitted, it also receive radiation from surroundings. So if we are considering these two bodies, for example, this is giving some radiation, it is emitting some radiation and to give this body. Now at the same time, it will get some radiation from this body also. Or we can call, if we consider only one body and its surrounding, so what is happening? It is emitting some radiation, at the same time it is absorbing some radiation from the surrounding. Okay, and this rate also depends on the surface and the temperature of surroundings. Okay, this is the reason we can actually explain why our body feel warm when we stand near fire. Okay, we can understand the logic. How we can understand what happened when we stand near the fire? At that time, our body received more energy from the fire. Then it can radiate or it can emit or it can lose its radiation, right? So the amount of absorption is more than the delivery, right? So that's why we are feeling hot. But if we stand near a ice block or in some icy place, what happened? Our body actually at 37 degrees, the temperature, normal temperature of our body is 37 degrees centigrade. So what happened? Our body lose some radiation, and the amount of this radiation is actually more than what our body can receive from the ice block or from the surroundings. Okay, so that's why our body feels cold near ice block, right? This exchange process continues until the thermal equilibrium is established. Okay, so our body continue to release some heat radiation and will continue to receive the radiation from ice block, or if we are standing near fire, it will continue to radiate, it will continue to receive some radiation from heat, and this process of exchange of heat will continue until the temperature of both systems or the body and surrounding get same. The temperature should be same. That means the thermal equilibrium is established. Okay, so that means we can say that all the bodies at any temperature are in a state of dynamic thermal equilibrium when they are at same temperature. Okay, they are known as in the state of dynamic thermal equilibrium, right? So this is about Provost's theory of heat exchange. Now we will go to our next topic, that is black body. So what is black body? Actually, there is nothing like a perfect black body, but we can hypothesize as that a perfect black body is a body which completely absorbs all the radiation of any wavelength which is falling on it. So it should be absorbing all the wavelengths, all the radiation, whatever it is exposing to, right? So the second point about black body, since it neither reflects or nor transmits any radiation, it completely appears black, whatever the color of incident radiation. Irrespective of the color of incident radiation, the black body looks always completely black because there is no reflection and no transmission occurred, right? The main characteristic of such kind of body is when the heat to suitable high temperature, it emits total radiation. First, it absorbs the radiation, and if we heat this to a particular temperature, it emits all the radiation, and that radiations are known as black body radiation. It is considered that a perfect black body, since it is a perfect absorber, that means it is absorbing all the radiations which are falling on it, that create a characteristic that it radiate also the same amount of radiation, and that radiation are known as black body radiations. These black body radiations does not depend on the type of object emitting it. It only depend, the total spectrum of black body radiation depends only on one parameter, that is the temperature at what we are heating that body, right? And as I told in the beginning of this black body, there is actually no perfect black body in real practice. There is always a loss of that radiation during the absorption and emission process. Okay, so there is no perfect black body, but definitely we can create some black body which is very near to the concept of black body, right? Now there are several scientists, several researchers who has prepared, who has designed some black bodies according to their hypothesis, according to their understanding. The first one was built by Ferry, and that is termed as Ferry's black body. It was quite popular in that time, but now it is changed and it was developed to some other kind. We will see later on. So as you can see in the image, a double walled hollow copper sphere was taken and it was coated with lamp black inside the surface. Okay, on its inner surface there was a coating of lamp black. This is quite normal. Lamp black is very near to the perfect black body material. It can absorb nearly all the wavelengths and all the radiations that is falling on it, and that's why this lamp black is always looked black. Like here, one very small fine hole H was remained, which is acting as a very narrow opening for this sphere. Now if we allow some radiation to enter through this opening, what they will do, it will, and there is one corner here on the surface, it was P is kind of pointed projection that was in the straight line of that point hole, right? So when the radiation goes inside, it get reflected and reflected, several reflections takes place. It behaves like a totally reflected, multiple reflection takes place, and after that it is completely absorbed by the body, by the surface. Okay, and that's why this black body act as a black body absorber. Now if we increase the temperature of this black body to some particular temperature, the heat radiation starts coming out of the hole, okay, and this hole act as a black body radiator. In the absorber case, this whole black body act as a black body absorber, but in the radiation case, only this hole actually act as a black body radiator. Not the whole body act as a black body radiator, only this hole act as a black body radiator. So this is about the structure of Ferry's black body. Second type of black body was constructed by Beam. Beam constructed a black body in the form of cylinder rather than spherical form. Okay, in that cylindrical form, the radiation was much better, and that's why it is commonly used nowadays due to its construction structure. It is more convenient to use. A square is difficult to use, to place it is difficult. That's why we are now using cylindrical type black body. So what it is consisting, if you look at the structure, this is the structure of Bean's black body. Here you can see this is the cylindrical form. Here we have coated this by either platinum black or lamp black, which are very near to the black body material. So this is the cylindrical structure. There was having the on the surface of this cylinder, there was some platinum wire that is shown as H here and H. These are platinum wire coil, which is used to heat the body. And finally, this whole structure was protected by porcelain tube to protect from the any outer damage. Okay, now the radiation emit out from this hole. This hole O is represented here, and this is focused by some convex lenses. Okay, so here is the thermocouple, which is placed to measure the temperature. So this is the structure, and the radiation from the cylinder was limited. Important point here is the radiation from cylinder is limited by blackened concave diaphragms and emerges out of the hole O. So again, similar to Ferry's black body, the hole O act as a black body radiator, right? Now we will go to our next topic, which is related to, which is given by Kirchhoff, and it is a law that states that the ratio of the emissive power to the absorptive power of a given wavelength at a given temperature is the same for all bodies. The ratio of emissive power and absorptive power for a given wavelength at a given temperature is always same and is equal to the emissive power of a perfect black body at that temperature, right? To prove this statement, let us consider that A lambda is the absorptive power of a body. Now let us assume that dQ is the quantity of heat that is lying within the wavelength of lambda and d lambda. This is the wavelength range where we are supplying dQ heat energy, right? And that heat energy is incidenting now on the unit area of that surface in 1 second. Then the total quantity of heat energy absorbed by the surface can be written as A lambda, absorptive power, into dQ. This is the quantity of heat energy within the wavelength lambda and d lambda and on unit area, right? So this is the unit area into A lambda. So A lambda into dQ will be the total quantity of heat energy absorbed by the surface. So the remaining energy will be what? dQ minus A lambda into dQ. That remaining energy will be either reflected or transmitted, or maybe it can be both reflected or transmitted. Somehow the emission is taking place, right? The only absorbed part was A lambda into dQ. Now this was about the absorptive power. If we consider it in terms of emissive power, let us consider that E lambda is the emissive power, right? Now the total amount of energy emitted per second per unit area between this wavelength lambda and d lambda by virtue of temperature, by heating it, is given by E lambda into d lambda. Very similar to this, here we consider A lambda into dQ. Now here, because this is the wavelength range, so it can be given by E lambda d lambda. So the total energy will be this energy plus the remaining energy after the absorption. That will be the sum of this. So the total energy given out per second per unit area of the surface will be given by dQ into 1 minus A lambda plus E lambda d lambda, right? And if we consider that the body and surrounding is in equilibrium state, then the total energy supplied will be equals to this energy emitted, right? So dQ will equals to dq into 1 minus a lambda plus e lambda d lambda. Now if we solve this, dq will cancel out dq. The remaining part will be a lambda dq equals to e lambda d lambda. Now if we consider a case of black body, what will happen? For black body, we always know that the absorptive power is 1. So a lambda equals to 1. And for black body, small e lambda becomes capital E lambda, the emissive power of black body, right? So we can put these values in this equation, and what we get from here, dq equals to capital E lambda into d lambda. Now putting this value in this equation, we get a lambda into capital E lambda into d lambda equals to small e lambda into d lambda. Now solving this d lambda and d lambda will cancel out. The capital E lambda will be equals to a small e lambda upon a lambda, and that's what we have written, that the emissive power to the absorptive power, the ratio of emissive power to absorptive power of any body is always constant, is always same, and that is equal to the emissive power of a perfect black body, that is always represented by capital E lambda. So this is already proved, the Kirchhoff's law is proven now in this way. Okay, let us go to the next topic, that is pressure of radiation, right? As we have already seen, the first case we will say when the radiation is falling normally, and the second term we will introduce diffuse radiation. Diffuse radiation means the radiation can be in all the direction, right? So now we have already assumed that the radiation possesses the properties of light and it follows all the laws that are applicable to light. So from the theory of light, we already know that light exerts a definite pressure on the surface. The amount is very low, it is very, very small, but actually there is a definite pressure that is exerted on the surface on which it is incident. Similar to light, Maxwell proved that on the basis of this electromagnetic theory, the pressure is equal to energy density, that means amount of radiation per unit volume for the normal incidence. Okay. This expression for the pressure of radiation is derived on the basis of quantum theory. Now let us consider that a photon of energy h nu moves with a velocity of c, that is the light velocity. Now according to theory of relativity, this energy of photon corresponds to a mass m is given by mc square equals to h nu, that is the energy of photon and that is the kinetic energy. So mc square equals to h nu, from here we get m equals to h nu upon c square, and that's why the momentum of the photon will be m into c, that will become h nu upon c, or we can write e upon c, where e equals to h nu is energy of photon. So there we get the momentum of the photon. Now the momentum is incidenting on the surface, pq per unit area per second can be written as p equals to summation of e upon c, right? Here we are considering that the radiation is incidenting on this. So p will be, this is the momentum of only one photon. Now we are considering on the this pq plane, the all the radiation which is lying on the pq plane will be the summation of e upon c, or we can c is constant, so summation will be on the e only. The summation e can be said total energy incident on the surface per unit area per second, and we are representing is by capital A, capital E for example. Now if we put this, we get p equals to capital E upon c. Now if we consider that u is the energy density, or we can call it energy per unit volume, then the total energy passing through area S of the surface normal to the incident radiation per second will be uc into S. Okay, and because of that, the energy flux, or we can call it energy radiation per unit area per second, can be given by E equals to ucs upon S is the surface area. S is the total area of that surface normal to incident radiation. So that will give us UC. E will be equals to UC. Now, if we put this value in our equation 2, we will get that P equals to UC upon C, that is equals to U. If all of this momentum is absorbed on the surface, it will give the rate of change of momentum per unit area, and that means it is equal to pressure of radiation, and that's why the pressure of radiation is equals to energy density for the normal incidence of radiation on that surface, right? So this is the expression for normal incidence. Now to consider, this is always not the case, the radiation is not only in the normal direction, it can radiate in all the direction, and that's why the nature is diffuse nature. Suppose the radiation is diffuse nature, that means photons can move in all possible direction, right? Now let us consider that the incident beam of radiation make an angle theta with the normal to the surface of LM. This is the surface LM and this is the normal. The radiation is making an angle theta degree with the normal, right? Now the energy incident on the surface KL, this part we are plotting this as making an angle theta, very similar. So this is very similar to normal incidence, right? Now the energy incident on the surface KL per unit area per second will be given by UC, that we have already seen in our last derivation, right? Now if we consider S is the surface area of plane KL, for example, so the energy incident on the surface KL in 1 second will be given by UC into S is the surface area, so UC into S. But the surface area of the plane KL will be equals to surface area of plane LM into cos theta. This is simple trigonometry. If we consider this triangle, we can say that KL will be equals to LM cos theta. This is simple trigonometry, and by putting here, now let us assume that the surface area of LM plane is given by S dash dot cos theta, right? Now S dash is the surface area of LM. So the energy incident on the surface KL per second will be given by UC into S dash cos theta, right? From the figure, you can consider that the total energy crossing per the plane LM is equals to the total energy crossing, the energy passing through the plane KL per second. Okay, this is very similar. Whatever radiation is passing this surface is equal to the radiation reaching to this surface. So we can write energy incident on the plane LM per second will also be equals to UC dot S dot cos theta. Right? This is the energy incident on plane LM. Now if we calculate per unit area of the plane LM, we get the expression by dividing this of surface area of plane LM. So that is given by UC dot S dot cos theta upon S dot S dash. Okay, so the final expression comes like UC cos theta. So this is the energy incident per unit area of the plane LM per second. Now the momentum incident the surface LM per unit area per second is given by UC cos theta upon C, and which is equals to U cos theta. So the component of this momentum in a direction normal to the surface LM is the surface this one. So if we plot a normal, then the component of this is this momentum in the direction normal to the surface LM will be given by U cos theta of into cos theta. Okay, so the total expression will become U into cos square theta. If all this momentum is absorbed, then equation 5 gives the total rate of change of momentum per unit area normal to surface, normal to plane LM, right? So that means that is equals to the pressure of radiation on the surface LM, which can be written as U cos square theta. This is the pressure of radiation, diffuse radiation on surface L. Now to calculate this, we need to do some calculations. We need to consider some mathematics. Now in the case of diffusion radiations, the radiation can be incident from all the possible direction with equal probability, right? So if we consider that there are total n beams of radiation which are meeting on the surface, the total radiation pressure can be given on the surface by summation of the u cos square theta, and that's what we have written here, is equals to summation of u cos square theta. Now we want to calculate this term. We have to imagine a hemisphere. Hemisphere is because of the radiation can be from any direction, and that will give you a shape of a sphere. Now we are considering a hemisphere, because once the radiation is coming from one direction, it can be in a hemisphere. Okay, now let us consider the radius of hemisphere is small r. Okay, and this is the center O of the element LM that is forming hemisphere from this side, right? Now from the surface of hemisphere, cut out a ring shaped AB and CD. You can see if we cut this hemisphere from these two rings, we will find this area ABCD, and this will be like a small ring, right? And it will be by means of two cones of angle theta and theta plus d theta along the normal of this LM plane. Okay, and the area of the ring can be written as 2 pi r sine theta, that is the periphery of this ring, into this distance, and this distance will be given by r into d theta, which is can be get from here. The r is the radius and d theta is this one, so we can get this value as r into d theta, and that's why the area will be become 2 pi r sine theta into r d theta, and that will become 2 pi r square sine theta into d theta. Now since n beams are considered to be uniformly distributed over the surface of hemisphere, okay, that is equals to half into 4 pi r square, because the area of hemisphere, surface area of the hemisphere, of the sphere is given by 4 pi r square. So the surface area of hemisphere will be given by half of 4 pi r square, which is equals to 2 pi r square, right? Then the number of beams that are crossing through the area of ring will be given by dn equals to the total area of ring divided by the area of hemisphere, right? So 2 pi r square sine theta d theta upon 2 pi r square into n beams. Total beams are n, so into n. So the final expression will come dn equals to n sine theta into d theta. Now let us consider that fraction of beams that are incident between angle theta and theta plus d theta in this region only, then it will be given by dn upon n, and that is equals to sine theta into d theta, and that's why the pressure can be written as p equals to dn upon n. These are the fraction of beams that are incident between theta and theta plus d theta, and we have already calculated the pressure of radiation on the surface LM is u cos square theta. So we have just multiplied by this dn upon n into u cos square theta, and it becomes u cos square theta into sine theta d theta. That is our equation number 9. Now if we consider several rings are forming there, for all the possible rings within the hemisphere, theta can be varied from C. If we consider this hemisphere, we can take several part of like this theta. Okay, we can cut very small rings. So the range will be theta equals to 0 to pi by 2, right? We can get all the rings in this region only. So we are integrating here now P equals to 0 to 90 of u cos square theta sine theta d theta, which we have got for the fraction of beams that are incidenting only between theta and theta plus d theta range. Now we are doing it from 0 to pi by 2. So we are integrating this term, and we are forming this u into integration 0 to pi by 2 cos square theta sine theta into d theta. Now to make it simplify, let us consider cos theta equals to x. If cos theta equals to x, then differentiate this, it will become minus sine theta d theta equals to dx. Putting these values in this equation, we get p equals to u, and integration limit will also change because cos theta, we are putting cos 0, that will become 1. So x equals to 1, and if we put cos 90, then it will become 0. So 1 to 0 limit into cos square theta is x square, and sin theta d theta is minus dx. So minus dx is written here. Now we can write it, we are changing the limit, it was 1 to 0. If we make it 0 to 1, the sign will change here. So it will become u integration limit 0 to 1 x square dx. If we solve this, we find u into x cube upon 3 within the limits of 0 to 1. If we solve this expression, we find u upon 3. That means the pressure of diffuse radiation is equals to 1/3 of total energy density. This is all about today's lecture. Now we will solve some quiz question to judge our knowledge, whatever we have grasped from today's lecture. So the first question of quiz is, which method of heat transfer does not require material medium? Conduction, convection, or radiation, or none of the above? Yes, the right answer is radiation, which does not need any material medium between source and receiver. So the right answer is C. The second question is, a perfect black body is that which is totally black in color, absorbs all the radiations incident on it. C option is made of ideal gas named Krishnika. Option D is can radiate all its energy. So definitely we have seen the definition of black body. Black body is that which absorbs all the radiation incident on it, irrespective of wavelength. It can absorb all the radiations of all the wavelengths. So the right answer is B. The third question is, good absorbers are good emitters. The statement is called Fermat's law, Kirchhoff's law, Stefan's law, or Wien's law. Yes, we have seen the Kirchhoff's law, and according to that, good absorbers are good emitters. The fourth question is, electromagnetic radiation is emitted by all bodies at all temperature, all bodies at 100 degrees centigrade, all bodies at absolute zero, or only a few bodies at all temperatures. So the right answer is A, all bodies at all temperatures. All the bodies emit some thermal radiation or electromagnetic radiation, right? Now the next question is, for a perfect black body, the absorptive power is 0, 1, 0.5 or infinite. We know the definition of black body, it can absorb all the radiations incident on it. That means the absorptive power should be 1. The right answer is C. The next question is, for normal incidence, the pressure of radiation is equal to, we have considered the last derivation of today's lecture, for normal incident it is equals to energy density U. That's why the right answer is option A, energy density. Then it is the question about the pressure of diffuse radiation. We have calculated in our last topic, and that is equals to P equals to U by 3. So that means 1 by 3rd of total energy density. So the right option is option B for this question. The next question is related to the wavelength of thermal radiation. We have introduced the electromagnetic spectrum, and I have shown there that thermal radiation lies between the broad range of that infrared spectrum, visible spectrum, and part of ultraviolet spectrum, and the total range is between 4000 to 8000 angstrom. So the right answer is B, 4000 to 8000 angstrom. Next question is, the energy of a photon is given by h nu, 2h nu, 3h nu, or 4h nu. Yes, photon is a bundle of energy, and the energy of that is h nu. So the right answer is A. The last question of today's quiz is, every body emits radiations continuously to its surroundings and at the same time it receives radiation from its surroundings. This statement is Planck's law, Stefan's law, Pervos theory, Kirchhoff's law. So yes, the heat exchange theory between source and surroundings, body and surroundings, is given by Pervos. So that is known as Pervos theory. That's all for today's quiz. I hope all the topics discussed today are pretty clear for you. We have learned about black body. We have learned about several laws related to radiation. So if you still have any doubt, you can write your comments in our YouTube channel of Suresh Gyan Vihar University School of Applied Science. You can send an email by asking your questions. I would be happy to answer all the questions. Thank you for listening. Thank you for your